Hello and good afternoon. You join us in the Botanic Gardens in Glasnevin in sunny northside Dublin. Now, you'll often hear the phrase, you know, if you're not feeling in great form, maybe after Christmas, why not get out in the fresh air, a bit of a walk in the countryside, a bit of a walk in the park or whatever. And, you know, it's a widely accepted thing, but what's the science behind it? Well, we're here with Botanic Gardens guide Gary Mentanko. And we're going to talk a bit about biophilia and, what's the phrase, horticultural therapy. So, Gary, what's it all about? What's the science behind it?
Well, I mean, biophilia itself, I suppose, is this idea that we, it's can be defined as, say, like the love of living systems, love of life, and that we are not separated by it. So that we live in our cities and we have our modern societies, that we have an evolved response to be around nature. And so the idea is that we sort of do better when we're exposed to nature or able to get to green spaces, and that it affects us physically, mentally, and has a kind of binding agent, I suppose, in society to sort of help us manage ourselves better. So that's kind of the idea. And a lot of topics to do with, say, horticultural therapy are involved in that, getting people to feel better in order by being around plants, making use of them, growing plants. So that's kind of what the idea of the tour that we're going to be doing is based on.
Okay, great. So we're going to delve into all that again, into the science behind it. Andrew, our cameraman, is showing us the lovely greenery around us. Just to get your bearings, that's Glasnevin Cemetery over there. Show them the tower there, Andrew. Glasnevin Cemetery, you can walk through from the Botanic Gardens. Met Aaron is behind us as well. So we're here just beyond Frisborough in North Dublin. So we're going to walk and talk in West Wing style. Andrew, if you want to swing around behind us, and we're going to head off this direction. So we'll be walking slowly, and we're going to be warning Andrew of any small bushes or rodents along the way. So, Gary, all right. First of all, the Botanic Gardens, I've told people more or less where we are, but tell us a bit of the history behind it.
Well, the origin of the gardens goes back to 1795, when the Royal Dublin Society, the RDS, which is still around, was establishing an institution to look at studying how crops grow and agriculture for you know, science, but also for profit, growing crops that are healthier.
Yeah.
For, I suppose, a lot of landowners at the time. And then really the gardens sort of diverted in their interest in the early 1800s, which is, I suppose, part of it has to do with horticulture, how to grow the plants that are being discovered around the world, so for our pleasure. And the other side of it having to do with botany. How are plants related to one another? How have they changed as they've moved throughout the world? And we're still involved in a lot of that type of research to do with conservation of plants, which are becoming, you know, rare in areas where people are changing how the land is. We have the threat of climate change. So environments which would have been the same for possibly millions of years are starting to change very quickly. Mm. So we're involved in sort of conservation projects to do with that, education with the public, engaging with them to come in. And I mean, there's an amenity value as well, which I suppose we're going to talk about, to be out in and amongst nature and natural things.
So we're walking along past these iconic greenhouse structures here in the Botanic Gardens up behind us here. And if you turn to your right there, Andrew, it's an enormous greenhouse here. What's inside here? What's the most unusual plant we might find if we walked inside here?
Most unusual plant inside these houses? Well, it's hard to say. There's certain ones that are very very rare in the world, particularly in this glasshouse here. This is the Turner Glasshouse, which dates, it was kind of built over a 25-year period, kind of piecemeal, and finished in the 1860s. But this glasshouse has some of our conservation project plants. So say things like from different islands around the world. Ireland's an island. Mm. Where you have islands, you have less diversity of plant life, animal life. They're not able to migrate easily. When there's catastrophes, they can get wiped out very easily. New things that come in can wipe them out or alter the escape. So some of the plants in there, particularly one from the from the Pitcairn Islands, plant which was only found there, so it's endemic to the islands. In one of our researchers had been there working on a project discovering a bit about this plant. In the meantime, it's basically gone extinct in the wild. It's not found there any longer, but it's in conservation projects here and in other gardens. And the concept, I suppose, of the idea is that some of these plants can get reintroduced into nature at some point once the problems, the overlying problems of, say, invasive species and how the land is managed are altered in some way. Right. So, yeah, that would be a very, very nice one. It blooms, you know, early part of the year, beautiful sort of yellow flower.
Okay.
But we've got so many weird plants, it's
okay.
Hard to bum out.
Well, we might come back for that blooming.
Sure, yeah.
Now, where are we? We're going to walk down this direction, I think,
yeah,
are we? Okay.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about horticultural therapy.
Okay.
You've been looking at the science behind it, and there, I know there's, it can benefit people physically as well as mentally. So tell us about the studies.
Absolutely. Well, let's say physically. I think like most people could understand that going to a green space, going to somewhere where it's natural, the ability to get there, to traverse it while you're there, has a physical benefit to us. But within that, they've done loads of studies to show that people who live near green spaces, let's say tree-lined streets, they have lower incidences of things like diabetes, they have lower cardiovascular problems, they have an ability to actually heal themselves better. So actually some of the interesting studies that came out of Uppsala University Hospital was that you have people that are observing not just nature, so they've had major cardiac surgery. They're not just observing say a window where you can see green. They actually just get something like a facsimile, a photo of a tree lined glen, and those people were healing faster than the other counterparts that had maybe an abstract picture or a stone wall image in front of them. And at the same time of this, they're using less pain medication, they're using lower doses of pain medication. So there's something about observing the forms of nature is appealing to us and probably helps our stress levels to come down. And when you have high stress levels, you physically heal slower. So I think that's kind of a fascinating thing to do.
And these could be people who are, it's not a view of a tree out the window, it could be just a screen with trees or a picture of trees.
Absolutely. Yeah. But I think you get better outcomes when you're around these actual things. Mm. And particularly if you're in areas where you can touch plants or you can smell them. If you look at some of the research that's going on, say in Japan, where you have something like this concept of forest bathing, city dwellers going out to the forest on the weekends to enjoy nature, I mean, their stress levels come down. They're being exposed to the scents of things like cedars or cypress trees, and that they know that helps to lower their stress levels. Helps.
Are we coming up to a cedar tree around here somewhere?
There's quite a few conifers going off into the distance there in Pine Hill, and so a lot of those would give off these kind of enzymes, these sort of scents that they've researched and just shown, you know, in a laboratory, in people even not exposed outside in a lab, that it lowers their stress levels. Okay. So I think that's kind of a fascinating thing that it does just to us.
And then let's guide us on here.
Let's go this way here. There's a nice view coming down, and then we'll be around loads of other sort of conifers.
Okay, perfect. Keep the camera on us, Andrew. Some dicey territory coming up.
Yes, sure.
If you want to scoot around here this direction, I'd say, and we'll let you know if you're about to fall over any potted plants.
Few steps here.
You're fine. Are we going the high road or the low road?
Yeah, we'll go down the low road.
The low road, okay. The cliff edge. So stay tuned. This could get interesting. So it's not just if you want to film forwards, that's probably the better idea. So it's not just physical improvements, but in terms of people who are, you know, may have mental health problems, may be suffering from anxiety.
Yeah.
What are the studies in that area show?
Well, let's see. Like for people that have anxiety, depression, maybe suffering from post-traumatic stress syndrome. Again, following on from sort of forest bathing in Japan or some of the research that's happening in South Korea with these kind of national parks where people are going for their mental health, they're finding that people are just getting, I suppose it's helping to sort of scrub their brain of the kind of the things that build up. So actually a very good study happened with in the University of Utah. David Strainer was looking at this idea called the three-day effect. So this is where people that are out in nature walking around after 3 days, their cognitive abilities start to improve immensely, and compared to sort of city dwellers. And what they started to find is that there's kind of theta waves in your prefrontal cortex. This is where all your decision making is happening, and when you have stress, you have anxiety, these things start to build up. It's almost like a battery. We're becoming depleted, and being out in nature helps to quell those, and they improve statistically hugely on cognitive tests, something like 47%, which is absolutely massive. So it does something. There's this kind of soft chaos in nature which sort of helps us to which helps to sort of quiet our brains,
right,
and makes us more creative. And so I think that's kind of a fascinating study.
I like that expression, soft chaos.
How
long do you need to be out in nature for the effect to be measurable, I suppose?
Well, there's that study, but there are other ones that have shown, I mean, even just a quick walk around a city park or a arboretum or something like that, in 50 minutes can also kind of boost your... 15 to an hour,
okay.
Sort of boost. So this is why we're always encouraging people, like, where you can... to get out, you know, to make use of the sort of parks that we have, you know, in the city. I mean, intrinsically, people in history would have known that there's some sort of value to being around green things or being around nature in some way.
Yeah.
So we definitely advocate, you know, trying to break the cycle. There's also been work that's been done in the University of British Columbia, which shows for people that say that are very busy, let's say you got to go catch the bus, you got to get to work or school, even that period of time, observing people's plants that they have in front of their houses, even like weeds that grow between the walls, being able to reach out and touch them and reflect on these sort of things helps to deal with I suppose a lot of buildup of anxiety and pressures of the world. So I don't know, there's something about them that is helping us.
Well, let's do that for a second ourselves, why don't we? Let's take a look around here at the nature. This stream runs through the gardens. I imagine that runs into the Talca down the road.
This is the Talca here. Yeah, we're looking at a cultivated, like a man-made island here. They was probably dug out when there was a mill here, maybe going back maybe 3 centuries now. And it's a nice kind of placid thing. I mean, we're in an old part of the gardens here, with just a kind of mixture of trees. Up ahead of us is a very large sequoia, which would have been one of the oldest ones to come here into Europe. So that's probably
which one is the sequoia here? Can you point it out for the camera?
Head, yeah, which is this the one that has brown stem here and is all evergreen. It's about the second tallest tree in the gardens. These come from California originally. And
these are the ones that if you're in California, you can have ones that are big enough for cars to drive through and all that sort of thing.
Absolutely, yeah. And they're some of the most long-lived trees in the world and some of the most largest living things in the world. So, I mean, they can live something like well over 2,000 years old. And they need a lot of requirements. I mean, you know, thousands of liters of water every single day. They're from the kind of trees that would have been around in the time of the dinosaurs. They sort of survived for a period of time when plants were all kind of, conifers like this. Things that had evergreen leaves, which didn't lose their leaves. And then later on, we got flowering plants. Things that required pollination for the most part. So they're sort of fascinating thing. And I talk about endemics. They're endemic to California.
Yeah.
They're sort of living in the same sort of environment, really, for millions of years, cultivating their own type of, their perfect growing conditions. Mm. So
In Ireland, I'd imagine they wouldn't grow as large as they would in California.
They probably won't. They'll certainly get large. Those ones have had, they, like I said, they have the perfect kind of growing conditions. Some of the oldest trees in the world are usually the trees that grew within a forest, and eventually the forest disappears over time. The tree's growing very slowly over time because it's been shaded out for so much of its life, so it becomes an incredibly dense type of tree. It has less possibility that it gets damaged, to get infection and all of this. So they likely won't get that large. But they do like the Irish weather. They like the kind of misty well, summers and winters, to be
summers
honest,
and winters and everything. All right, well, let's take a walk down towards this bridge here. We might finish up down there.
Yeah.
So tell us a little bit about the, there's been a lot of interest in the tour, this particular tour.
Absolutely, yeah. We had it last Saturday. Lots of people who've been, who come to the gardens or people that say that were involved in going to events on this first fortnight program seem to be quite interested. So there's a desire. I mean, we with these kind of busy lives, I think people have an appreciation that these things do something for us. If we were to look at like something like in society, they've shown that where you have green spaces, where you have tree-lined streets, you have people that feel more comfortable leaving their houses and going out, and then that starts to fall upon all the things that we've sort of talked about. Particularly if you look at, say, older people. These are people who are like most at risk of being, left on their own.
We're going past some rushing water, which might interfere with our audio. So
we could go up this way.
Yeah, let's skulk over here. I'm not sure whether it will or not.
But you have like people that have, they're the most at risk of being isolated. But if their communities are they feel that they feel safe, they feel engaging, they'll go out more, and then that affects them mentally, that affects them physically. People that they've proven in Japan anyway that people that are elderly people that live in tree-lined streets live longer than people that live in areas where there's a lot of concrete. It creates a sense of fear. We've these are like biological responses that we've evolved with, that to be around. The last 100 years has been a massive change in the way people live. Mm. So we're living in our cities. So there's something that's advantageous to being around plants in history. If you saw a flower, thousands of years ago, you might think there's food there at some point in the future.
We're steering poor Andrew into the wilderness here. There's a tree right behind you, Andrew. As you just go around this.
Where you see green things, you know, there's water. You know, there's indicators. This is how we've survived for so long.
Yeah. Okay, let's pause here as we finish up. So this specific tour, if people are interested, where should they look?
You can come to you can check on our website here or on the First Fortnight website. Yeah. We'll be running it at 2:30. It'll be quite popular. We ran it with, you know, quite a few people, nearly 100 last week. If there's more people than that, we'll run it again the following hour. And it's really
walk. It's Saturday, is it?
It's this Saturday, yeah. It's a brisk walk around the perimeter of the garden, so that's just over a 2-kilometer walk. Weather should be good, so hopefully we won't get rained on.
Okay, and it's not just the Botanic Gardens, obviously, in terms of OPW sites and other sites around the country. You know, it's about getting people out in the fresh air and looking at amenities near them.
Absolutely. We've come off of, you know, Christmas is stressful for everyone. We want people to get out and get exercise, energy. Exactly. You can come here to the Botanic Gardens. We're lucky here in Dublin that we have all of these kind of city parks, Merrion Square, Phoenix Park. You know, these are places which were inaccessible to most people in the past. They were things for the rich, and now they've been there's a cry out for needing green spaces, and they became something that the people can use. So we encourage people to come to places like this. Go out to the countryside, go to heritage sites, OPW sites. It would be, you know, we want people out, sort of out and engaging with it. Even if they don't understand, plants are confusing, you can't all be horticulturists, but they're curious. They make your mind curious for what's happening, and I think that sort of has a lot of benefits to people.
Okay, Gary Mentanko, thanks for your time today. It's been very interesting having the tour of the Botanic Gardens. We'll leave it there, so please like and share on Facebook, and we look forward to your comments.